Johan Cruyff. Taking football to another level as a player, he did exactly the same in the coaching role. In the days of cautious tactic and mainly defensive schemes, Cruyff's Barcelona amazed by their uncompromised attitude as much as by the one-touch pass technique. Firm and demanding person, the Dutchman always aspired to perfection, pushing his team hard, sometimes even too hard, which many great players could vindicate. But without this extreme, as well as without his other shortcoming in the form of arrogance, he wouldn't be himself, he wouldn't be Cruyff. The coach who completely changed Barcelona's fate and faith, achieved a great deal in a relatively short period of time, and left some brilliant samples of attacking and highly intelligent football. Marcello Lippi. There were a few genuinely great Italian managers, but none of them can compare with the former Juventus' boss in flexibility. All Lippi's best teams, not only the old lady, but also the Squadra Azzura, were like chameleons, smoothly and promptly switching from one style of play to the other. For example, his Juventus in the 1994-1995 glorious campaign merged the combinational and fast football with the classic Italian one, and later Lippi did this trick many times. He also certainly opened the new horizons, if we are talking about the versatility of players and lineup rotation. Almost all of his footballers, excluding goalkeepers and pure forwards, performed on different positions, which enabled Marcello to transform the squad as frequently as the modern coaches are doing it now. Fabio Capello in 1992 was the first who started to use much more than 15-16 footballers, a classic number in those days, but he seldom made modifications in the defensive line. His compatriot went much further. Lippi often rotated even the back four, especially on the flanks, keeping his team fresh and agile during the whole grueling season. In this regard, he certainly showed the way for others. The Italian's main weakness was his complicated character. The boastful and acrimonious Marcello often lost the sense of proportion, especially after a lot of tough years in the profession, in the days of big wins. That's why his illustrious career has been tarnished by so many embarrassing debacles. Sven-Goran Eriksson, who worked almost in the same style as Lippi, and for this reason often used the similar players, is an ambitious number two in this ranking. Otmar Hitzfeld. Lippi's old foe in a lot of classic coaching duels in the middle of 1990s, the German was genius of adjustments. Hitzfeld masterfully adapted not only to his personnel, but also to concrete form of his team, sometimes completely changing an approach right over the course of the season. For instance, starting the 1998-1999 campaign at the helm of Bayern with a good-looking dynamic football, he after the injuries of Lizarazu and Elber switched to a pragmatic play and almost won the Champions League in this manner. 7 Bundesliga titles and 2 Champions Cups illustrates how skillful Otmar was. But 10 stressful seasons at Borussia Dortmund and Bayern between 1991 and 2002 burned him out, and after that, the ingenious Otmar visibly lost some of his luster. Arsène Wenger, who was also born in 1949, in terms of legacy is a figure at least of the same size, but it's hard to argue that Hitzfeld's trophies are more numerous and prestigious. Vicente del Bosque. The Spaniard's career shows pretty well how crucial for coaches are a good taste to football and tact, provided that they are supported by the players of appropriate class and caliber. Del Bosque wasn't the best of tactics, and his methods of physical preparation were quite marginal, to say the least. That's why Real at the beginning of the century, even during glorious seasons, sometimes couldn't win in 4 or 5 games in a row. Moreover, the Spaniard rotated the lineup in the strangest way, simply refusing to rest his winded stars, save in some insignificant matches, only exacerbating the problem. But at the same time, he so masterfully found the exact role for each star and was so brilliant in constructing of the passing game that these deficiencies were reliably disguised for the vast majority of spectators. Not for Florentino Perez's perspicacious eyes, though. Seeing that his team is gradually aging, the Real president opted to not renew Del Bosque's contract in 2003, and in a way was right, given what happened with the Spanish national squad in the last 3 years of Vicente's long and prolific tenure. Excellently managing well-functioning teams, the master-shared specialist was too conservative and slow-thinking in order to make necessary adjustments in a short period of time. Perez was wrong in the other way. He didn't find a proper heir to Del Bosque until 2010, but it's obviously a different story. Louis van Gaal. There was no better tactic than him among the elite passing coaches, and nobody else discovered talent so suddenly and frequently. But van Gaal's notorious complicated character was even more visible. This was the reason why almost all his teams could be trounced in every single moment. And that's why people tend to judge the Dutchman's achievements and himself so harsh, especially for a man who won so much. Bert van Marwijk. After plenty of prolific years, 1952 was definitely a lean one. Next to Beckenbauer, Sacchi, Cruyff and Lippi, van Marwijk seems like a mediocre coach, especially with regard to his reputation and skills. The Dutchman, though, had his moments of glory. Many of his colleagues would like to win the UEFA Cup and lead a national team to the World Cup final. But even in the days of success, van Marwijk's Feyenoord and Netherlands didn't look particularly spectacular and compelling. Manuel Pellegrini. The Chilean coach clearly demonstrates what is the difference between being good and being truly great. Pellegrini, whose heart belongs to an attractive attacking football, was at his absolute best at Villarreal and Malaga, where the pressure and expectation were quite low and couldn't fully express himself at Real and Manchester City, where demands were extremely high. On the other hand, it would be wrong to say that the Chilean has failed at the Santiago Bernabeu and especially at the Etihad, where he won some important trophies. This shows that Pellegrini had, at least at his coaching prime, a standard of quality, the standard which brings him on top of this year. Fernando Santos. The Portuguese veteran crowned his long career by winning in 2016 the European Championship with his native national team. Experienced and steady professional, he is the type of coach whose class is rather determined by the number of mistakes than by creative ability. On his long way, Santos made very few blunders. That's why he is the best football manager born in 1954. Hector Cooper. There are very few coaches here who didn't win a single prolonged tournament, and the Argentine is certainly the most famous of them. To a certain extent, his managerial career resembles the notorious task of Sisyphus. Since 1997, during 6 full seasons, Cooper, who at his prime was a great motivator and very skillful defensive coach, did almost everything right at Mallorca, Valencia and Inter, only in order to fail at a crucial time. 5 consecutive unsuccessful attempts to win a prestigious title broke in his spirit, and following the dismissal from Inter in 2003, the Argentine has been only a shadow of former self. Anyway, Cooper remains the best football coach among those who were born in 1955, and it's hard to dispute it. Gregorio Manzano. This year provided very few famous players and was even more stingy in terms of successful football managers. Manzano is probably the best of them. Working in a typical Spanish style and mostly relying on a possession type of football, that's why he often replaced his compatriot Luis Aragonés in different clubs. Gregorio won the Spanish Cup with Mallorca in 2003. This is his major accomplishment. After that, he labored hard and long in several teams, including Atletico Madrid. but has been almost always limited rather by his personnel than by his own skills. Nevertheless, Manzano is a well-respected figure in Spain and he's on top of this rating, even if it's mainly due to little competition. Let's be fair. Cesare Prandelli, tactically flexible coach with a good taste to attack in football in many ways reminding Lippi. Working at Parma and Fiorentina, Prandelli not only fulfilled the potential of his teams, but even exceeded the expectations. His finest coaching hour was in the Euro 2012, when he has led his national team to the silver medals, despite a very strong opposition. But 2 years later, as is often the case, the success turned into crisis. Failure in the World Cup 2014 did hurt not only Cesare's pride, but also damaged his professional reputation, and it was easy to see during the Italian's work at Galatasaray, Valencia and Genoa. Lucien Favre is a serious adversary for Prandelli. If he will add some trophies to the entertaining football, his Borussia Dortmund usually shows the Swiss could overtake Cesare in his virtual rating within a year or two. David O'Leary. How fast time goes by. It seems not long time ago this Irish dandy was leading Leeds to the Champions League semi-final, but in reality almost 20 years have gone since that moment. Replacing George Graham at Leeds in 1998, O'Leary instantly changed the face of his team. Instead of slow, dull and low-scoring football, he proposed a high-paced play, probably the fastest on the continent back at the time, and brought a lot of young starlets, including Rio Ferdinand at the Elland Road. The results have been almost immediate. Leeds became a legitimate top club in England and left a serious mark at the European scene. But success usually creates pressure, and the Irishman's fate proves it very well. By 2002, Leeds buried in debts, and this very much affected David's career. He didn't manage to cope with enormous pressure, and after spending a big deal of energy, didn't find himself at Aston Villa either. After 3 mediocre seasons at the Villa Park, O'Leary effectively retired at the age of 48, barring a brief and thoroughly ordinary spell at Al Ahly. But at least earlier he's got a lot to remember. Carlo Ancelotti. In more ways than one, he's the Italian equivalent of Sir Alex Ferguson. A man of great poise and tact, Ancelotti prefers to influence his team mainly as a master of communication and only after that as a typical football coach. As is Sir Alex, Carlo is extremely good at keeping successful clubs intact and don't like to work with those that are building from scratch. You may argue that Ferguson won much more, especially on the domestic level, but let's not forget that Ancelotti succeeded in several countries. The feat makes him the figure of international level, and definitely the best football manager who was born in 1959. Rafael Benitez. Perhaps in none of the cases the battle was so hard-fought and intense. It's really tough to choose between Benitez and Joachim Löw, not least because the Spaniard and the German have worked in a completely different dimensions. The first one only on a club level, while the major part of the second one's career is inextricably linked with the national team. Both of them are pretty equal in their heights. Benitez won the Champions League and twice the UEFA Cup. Löw has led Germany to victory at the World Cup. Both had their share of losses and lived a long life in football on the highest possible level. I would give the Spaniard a slight edge though. Unlike the German, he proved himself in a lot of teams and in several different countries, and it's an important criteria. Thomas Schaaf. A worthy heir of Rehagel, Schaaf was a classic one-team coach, but his results in a small budget Werder were so consistent within almost a decade that it's safe to say that there was no better and more respectable manager born in 1961. Frank Rijkaard. Some coaches could be successful being only surrounded by the great players, and the Dutchman is a prime example of it. There is nothing to be ashamed, though. Plenty of Rijkaard's colleagues didn't excel even in these comfortable conditions. And he did. His Dutch national team in 2000 and Barcelona from 2004 to 2006 were the ones to watch. After that, mental fatigue took its toll on Frank's career, and he never was the same, but by the time his place in this rating was effectively reserved. Jose Mourinho. Like Trapattoni in the late 1970s and Capello in the early 1990s, the Portuguese sufficiently raised the bar of coaching professionalism. Mourinho didn't invent a new tactics and left not so many examples of failing football, but definitely changed the game in a different manner. His approach was so meticulous and methodic, attention to details so big and all-encompassing, training sessions so well thought out and intense that all of his assets became a standard of excellence for years. Add to this José's famous ability to establish and retain contact with the squad, multiply it by his personal charisma, and you get an answer why he was the most productive coach during over a decade. But the time is flying and football came far ahead, as opposed to Mourinho, who went in the other direction. Overstressed by a grueling work during many years, he now looks more like a yesterday man than a current top coach and virtually became a victim of his well-earned success. Ernesto Valverde, an accurate, hard-working coach who is especially good in routine on everyday basis. The problem is that common fans rarely appreciate those kind of virtues. Valverde's managerial signature certainly is not flashy, but in 2019 his diligent and relentless work enabled an aging Barcelona team to look like genuine favorite in every tournament until early May. Laurent Blanc. His four Ligue 1 titles may look not particularly impressive, but let's not forget one thing. Blanc has won not only with the mighty PSG, but also with the relatively modest Bordeaux. His three consecutive Champions League quarterfinals seems more like a failure either, but his successors couldn't even repeat this type of performance to date. It's hard to ignore that the Frenchman has one obvious and major professional weakness though, being a very skillful passing coach with a great taste to the attacking combinational game, Laurent not near as good in terms of physical preparation. That's why his teams always faded away at the second half of a season and couldn't prove themselves on the highest level. Marcelino Garcia Taral is very close to Blanc in this virtual competition and may easily surpass him in the upcoming years if the Spaniard will do a job in his next club on the same level as it was at Villarreal and Valencia. Zlatko Dalic. If not the emergence of the Croat, who came from almost nowhere to lead his national team to the World Cup 2018 final, this column risked to stay empty. 1966 wasn't rich on the football managers of the highest level. There is no doubt in it. Jurgen Klopp. Only a year or two ago, this spot would be reserved for Massimiliano Allegri, but Klopp's recent feats enabled him to overtook the Italian. Long-time admirer of the fast football, the German not only magnified it, but also enriched and innovated by combining the tempo of play with intelligence and witty passing. Being as good in a role of talent discoverer, the Liverpool's coach certainly isn't perfect. Jürgen's professional signature is odd, sometimes it looks even archaic. For instance, Klopp is using only a small group of players, especially by the modern standards, and simply hate to participate in more than two big tournaments simultaneously. But the Reds fans could easily forgive him for it now when, after all trials and tribulations, their favorite club is ready to win the Premier League. Didier Deschamps. Among the world-class football managers, he is definitely the most underrated, especially in terms of media attention. This is largely due to ever-decreasing prestige of national squads, but also could be explained by Didier's difficult character. Arrogant, conceited, and extremely irritable, the Frenchman is tough to deal with. Otherwise, his coaching career would have been even more brilliant. using his almost exclusive knowledge, especially in terms of physical preparation. Deschamps has guided Monaco to the Champions League 2004 final, later had a successful stint at Marseille, and in 2018 made Les Bleus the strongest national team in the world, prior to that leading them to the second place at the home Euro 2016. These are amazing accomplishments, but he could have achieved even more, keeping in mind how many seasons the Frenchman spent on the periphery of his profession. Antonio Conte, his tenacity and work rate are second to none. That's why his teams are usually so good and stable on the long distance. Conte's weakness is a lack of creativity. It's much easier for him to control a mental and physical state of his players month in and month out than invent one nifty attacking combination a la Guardiola or Zidane. In this regard, the Italian very much reminds his older compatriot Capello. Diego Simeone, none of the other prominent football managers embodies his teams to such an extent. Arriving in Madrid in the midst of dismal 2011-2012 season, the Argentine completely transformed Atletico's playing and mental style within few weeks, transition from mainly attacking football to a typical pragmatic and Italian type of play not only went incredibly smoothly, but proved to be a masterstroke, bringing a string of trophies to the Vicente Calderon and Wanda Metropolitana. Recent years weren't so productive for Simeone though, and even if there is a growing feeling that he already passed his peak, but in a way the drop of Atletico's form only stresses the stature and importance of the Argentinian's job. 10 years ago a season like the current one would be considered rather as a success. Josep Guardiola, unique ability to construct team plays and unwavering desire to dominate in every minute of every game separates him from the other colleagues and makes special. The irony is that exactly this ambitiousness regularly let Guardiola down in the Champions League. The football he cultivates is so sophisticated and energy-consuming that his teams often simply don't have enough gas in the tank when April or May comes. Having said that, the Spaniard remained in many ways and in the eyes a lot of people the best manager in the world, despite not lifting the Champions Cup since 2011. Zinedine Zidane, if we combine achievements in the role of footballer and coach, only Beckenbauer and Cruyff could state with the Frenchman. Many years working with a lot of great managers, Zidane took the best from each of them, from Ancelotti his unique composure, from Lippi the talent to effectively rotate the lineup and recuperate the energy, from a major key the ability to distance himself from criticism, whether it be media or fans, and from Del Bosque his taste to the passing game, although more accurate to say that Zidane had this gift from the date of birth.